still to come. At 10, it's Simon Bates. From 9, Sarah Cox. Right now, it's Simon Mayo.
BBC Radio 1 Vintage.
Hello, I'm Simon Mayo at Radio 1 from 1986 to 2001. When I was growing up, there was no alternative to Radio 1, really. It was the only station that you aspired to work for. It was certainly the only station I wanted to listen to. Though I remember my father saying, when it was announced that Radio 1, 2, 3 and 4 were going to be created, I remember him saying, although he always denied it, they were talking about Radio 1 being pop music all the time. He said, well, we're not having that on in this house. Little did he know.
The time just coming out to 1 minute past 9 o'clock. We're back here in the studio and...
Tony Blackburn, the golden hour, here on Radio 1.
And for the next
Tony hour, Blackburn, I listened to Noel Edmonds all the way through school. When I got to sixth form, I listened to Johnny Walker. He did a lunchtime show and I was in charge of the tuck shop. This is at Worthing Sixth Form College. And we just had Johnny Walker on all the time. And one of the great joys of working in Wogan House is to occasionally see Johnny. In fact, I think he's in today because he was always my all-time favourite presenter and still is. I would listen to him doing anything.
It's Radio 1. It's 3:19. Johnny Walker here for a bank holiday Saturday. Bits of paper everywhere. I got a call from...
It was absolutely always the only place to listen and the only place to work. So getting to Radio 1 was kind of a big deal. I had invented a quiz with a friend of mine and I had thought, Radio 1 does quizzes, but they're not very good. So I designed a new one, which is more like a game show, which was called Globe Phone. It was basically various geographical clues. You had to work out where the person was on the other end of the phone. It wasn't half bad, actually. But anyway, we made the tape, and then I sent off, and Johnny Beerling received one of them. He was the controller, and he listened to it. He listened to it when he was on the underground, and he missed his tube stop. And he took that as an indicator. He was so lost in this quiz that he missed the tube stop. So he then came out, and he rang me up, and I was at my desk at Radio Nottingham, and the woman on reception went on the tannoy and said, call for you, Simon. So I went, and I said, who is it? And she said, it's the controller of Radio 1. And I assumed that she was joking because that's the call. That's the call that you want to get. No, it surely can't be. Anyway, so it was Johnny. So he said, you want to come down? So I came down. And the first thing that I did, and I have a recording, I was recorded off the AM, was I did a 2-week debt for Gary Davis. So that was lunchtime. This was a huge big deal because the Tuesday was famously when they unveiled the chart. As a kid, I would take my radio into school so that I could hear the top 40 being announced. So to actually be announcing the top 40 was head spinning and genuinely terrifying.
Everyone's saying, what does it feel like to start a brand new breakfast show? Feels more than anything like the first day of term at a new school.
I look back on the on starting at breakfast now. It was very strange, very peculiar period because Mike Smith had been doing breakfast and had announced that he was leaving because he had lots of TV work. And it was basically between me and Nicky Campbell. So I knew I was in with a shout because I'd been Mike's dep. You know, when Mike went on holiday, I stood in for him. And I was okay. Anyway, I got the gig and I was delighted because, you know, to do the breakfast show at Radio 1 is the biggest gig still now. You know, it's still a wonderful show to do. But it was weird because I was given no production support at all. We kind of launched on the basis of nothing. We kind of staggered onto the air. I don't think we tried out anything. We hadn't pioneered any ideas. We hadn't run through any ideas. We kind of got it right because no one had done the kind of zoo format at breakfast before. As the dog bites with another saucepan on its head. It worked because the atmosphere on the show worked, and it worked because also, frankly, we were turning on FM transmitters left, right and centre, which meant the audience figures were great. So I look back on it fondly because it was, you know, an amazing period of my life.
How are we sounding? What's the FM sounding like?
The key, I think, was for us, we got the right producer. But it's the ability to make every day special. You know, when you've got an ordinary Tuesday with nothing happening, no big guests, no big releases, can you make that Tuesday feel fabulous? And all the successful breakfast shows are the shows that can do that. You've got nothing. You just got the raw material of each other and the songs that have been programmed for you. What can you make of it? And I think, by and large, that's what we did that was successful.
Yes, Albin Ernest Adagio, so it's confession time, and Tori
Confessions was a breakfast creation, and it came about, as I remember, it was like it was a record amnesty. We'd made the day special by saying, if you've got some records in your collection, which you should have given back weeks, months, years ago, tell us about them, and then we'll announce what you've done, and you can apologise to the person you've borrowed them from, and then you can hand them back. And quite extraordinarily from that, people said, oh, while I'm on, can you also tell him, you know, that I ran over his cat, you know, that kind of thing. You go, oh, okay, fine. And it just took off from there. I remember the first track was Somewhere in My Heart by Aztec Camera, which whenever I hear it now, still terrifies me, along with And She Was by Talking Heads, which was the first track they ever played. So they still send shivers down. But, you know, I was poor. I mean, I remember when, and I think I tweeted this actually, when Nick Grimshaw started, I was flabbergasted by how cool and confident he sounded. And I was contrasting it with the way I know I would have sounded when I started. I thought, this guy is astonishing. So I don't really want to hear any of that early stuff at all. None of it. Damn.
To hear the full interview, download the podcast at bbc.co.uk/Radio 1 Vintage.
Radio 1. The UK's favourite DJs. Simon Mayo, Radio 1. Vintage.
In the beginning, there was Tony Blackburn.
Nothing like giving yourself a round of applause before you start.
And then came Noel Edmonds.
Hello, good morning.
And then there came Mike Reed.
And you know how you get those urges?
Followed by the man they named Mike Smith.
Question is, which unusual vegetable?
And now...
Smee, Simon Mayo, good morning.
Blimey, what do I say now? I'd worked out what I was going to say to start with, but I resort to the script. 7:04, good morning, that's Aztec Camera, Somewhere in My Heart. Everyone's saying, what does it feel like to start a brand new breakfast show? Feels more than anything like the first day of term at a new school. Have you ever been the new kid at the new school in your new school uniform and feel all sort of out of place and no one talks to you? Worried about the homework? That's what I'm feeling now. We've got a great new field of breakfast. Hope you're going to like it. Just don't know what to tell you about first. First news coming up after Clyde Fisher.
This is me. I don't wear a disguise. This is me. Don't try and change it.
Clymie Fisher and This Is Me. It's taken me 5 weeks to get used to waking up early. That's what I've been doing all this time. And you may well have read that there is going to be a team looking after you, getting you up for breakfast every morning. I'll introduce you to the various members of the team as they crop up. The first one is here. Her name is Carol Dooley. Good morning.
Good morning.
Taking care of the travel and weather. Where do you come from?
That's right. I come from the Emerald Isle. Kilkenny, actually.
And your life history in 10 seconds.
My life history in 10 seconds, I think I'll do it in 5. Kilkenny, Dublin, Liverpool, here.
And that will do nicely. Yes, the other member of the team you will have heard of already. His name is Rod McKenzie. We'll be talking to him in just a second because on the new breakfast show, we have news headlines every 20 minutes for you.
Thank you for coming home. Sorry.
Hi, this is Simon Mayo. You're listening to Radio 1 Vintage. Still to come.
So it's confession time, and Tori Amos has joined us this morning, as I promised. Morning, Tori.
Hi, Simon.
How are you?
Fine.
This is Mick Jagger. How you doing, Mick?
I'm not so bad.
You've been around a while, so it's about time you were God in our
well,
eyes.
Well, yes, it's God old. This is the problem.
I don't think you do, so you and me are through. Radio 1 Vintage!
Oh, we're in FM in the southwest of England and in South Wales. Port Talbot, hello. Barry, Minehead, Glastonbury, Street. Hello, Yeovil, how are we sounding? Shaftesbury, fire those cannons. Crewkerne, hello. Wellington, Ilminster, Nailsworth,
Gloucester and Cheltenham, Ross on Y. Monmouth, have I mentioned you? Where else are we going? Pontypridd, Merthyr Tydfil, Ebervale. How are we sounding? What's the FM sounding like? Sounding pretty darn good to us. What the hell are we playing Tchaikovsky for? That's what I want to know. Oh, Dire Straits FM, this is what we need. Louder! Woo! Radio 1 in FM, sounding better than ever.
Simon Mayo, Happy Radio.
We have specially selected this record to sound particularly good in stereo. What's that? It's in mono. A little mono recording for you here. Now listen, Happy Radio, that's what Radio 1 is all about. And still, as Steve says, loud and proud on 1053 and 1089. But the FM is coming your way.
Yes, Albinoni's Adagio, so it's confession time, and Tori Amos has joined us this morning, as I promised. Morning, Tori.
Hi, Simon.
How are you?
Fine.
Welcome.
Nervous. I've never confessed anything before.
Really? Oh, well, I suppose not. And when you're a daughter of a Methodist preacher, and confessional isn't big in Methodist circles, so...
No, we hide those.
Oh, we hide them.
We just take our communion and say all is well.
Okay, well, do you have a story that you'd like to share with us? Because you're going to be doing some singing later. But a story, first of all?
There's a story.
Mm-hmm. Is this going to be shocking, by the way? Should we be sort of bracing ourselves for a bad
no,
one?
No. This is a very sad story, actually.
Okay.
Dear Father Simon.
Yes, Tori.
I think you will understand what it's like to be a girl if you could just imagine being 13 years old. Just having gotten off your braces, kind of being a nerd, but not totally a nerd, just mm-hmm. kind of a nerd. So, in other words, I sat in the middle of the bus, not the back of the bus where all the cool people sat, and not the front of the bus where the real, real serious nerds sat. Anyway, I was in the middle of the bus, and the most popular girl in school happened to be on the bus that day because she was going home with a boy that day that rode my bus, who was really cute and yeah. popular, too.
Okay.
So anyway, they took my books, and 'cause this one boy in the back wanted me to hang out with him. So I had to go to the back to get my books.
So they were kind of taunting you, are they?
Yeah.
By taking your books, yeah.
Now, this girl would do this to a lot of other girls. Just stuff, make them feel stupid and humiliate them in front of class, you know, because mm-hmm. she was attractive and all the boys liked her. They couldn't see the slime she was. So anyway, I went back. She was a cornflake girl. Anyway, I went back to the back of the bus with this guy, and he was kind of burly and sweaty and gross, and but tough and... like a young Sylvester Stallone.
I got it.
So anyway, he's sitting there pawing me and stuff, and I get really sick of this news, so I clock him one, and I shove him in the ribs with my elbow.
Nice one.
And I know it's near my stop, so I've got to get off. Well, this girl has hidden my books. So I take my books, I take her head in my hands, and I take my hand, and instead of marring her beautiful skin, I hit her on the top of the head.
Fantastic.
And I get my books, and she says, "I'm going to come after you, you little scum." So she, for the next 3 months of school, she made my life a living hell. Every day, it was awful, screaming outside my house to come fight her. Well, I didn't want to fight her because, you know, I'd done my bit. So one day, she got up from her desk, and she was walking, and everybody started to laugh at her. And they laughed and laughed, and she couldn't understand why. And me and my friend Connie had a packet of ketchup that we'd taken from cafeteria. And we just happened to put it beneath her white jeans before she sat down. And it's the only thing that got me through 3 months of hell.
Revenge is mine!
I like it. So is that the end?
That's the end.
So that's a happy ending then.
Well, it's kind of a happy ending.
Did she know who it was who'd done that?
No.
phew, you got away with it.
Yeah.
Could be a couple of songs and a video at least, I would think. So that's Tori's story. She got her own back on this horrible old cow of a girl by putting some tomato ketchup on her seat right by her white jeans.
Underneath her white jeans. Yeah.
Did it look effective?
Yes.
Did it look good?
It looked great.
It had the impact you wanted?
Totally.
Okay. Collective, it's over to you. What do you think of that? Time to have another God of the Week, and this is Mick Jagger. How you doing, Mick?
I'm not so bad.
You've been around a while, so it's about time you were God in our eyes.
Well, yes, it's God old. This is the problem. I mean, he may be completely young and...
well, speaking of God, I was just thinking, because you've been having hit singles. I was thinking in the UK, the only person who's been going longer than you is Cliff. Would that be about right?
I have no idea. I mean, who else?
Dusty well, Cliff
Springfield.
Was 58.
Dusty Springfield, who's had revived things. The Rolling Stones haven't really had many hit singles lately, but it's such a sort of lottery, the hit single market. But anyway, it's nice to have.
Yeah, but hit albums you have on a,
hit albums,
on a fairly regular basis. And here's another one, which is Stripped, half acoustic and half live, which we'll talk about a bit later. Do you think it'd be possible for you to live without recording and without touring? I mean, why are we doing this? Why are you still doing this? Is this because you couldn't live without it, really?
You see, the thing is, what I do best is singing and performing and playing and everything. So if I didn't really do that, it's a bit like not having Simon Mayo on the radio. I mean, it's just like a life not worth living.
Please, flatter me.
And you know, so it, you know, it's a sort of stupid
thing. Well, can you just run around the world on cruises or whatever?
That sounds really dull to me. But no, I think it's all very well having leisure, but it's good to have your métier and strut your stuff and so on. I think it's really important to you. And if you've been successful at it before, then even more importantly, you should continue doing it.
Are there any bands you're excited about? I mean, the reason I ask is that over here, the Brit pop thing is perceived to be the most exciting thing that's happened to British music for a while.
I think it's interesting enough. You know, how long it's going to last and how exciting it really is. It's been like a couple of years now, really. I mean, it seems to have caught momentum in the last few months even more, but it's been around for a little bit. And what's interesting for me, really, is a kind of a revival, in a way, of a lot of stuff that was very much the bread and butter of 60s pop.
So you know, are you saying it's not very new? Or
no, it's new in the production, but the actual idea of it, of the tune and so on, rather than the groove. Mm. A lot of music lately has been a lot of groove, you know, it depends what you listen to, of course, but I mean, I'm talking about pop music, it's been a lot of groove content over song content, which is, I actually don't mind that at all. I don't really like nifty little pop songs very much, but nifty little pop songs were the bread and butter of the 60s, and some of them were just dreadful.
Are you talking like Esther and Abby Ophirim?
Yeah, no, but even earlier, you know, all the groups that came out that were sort of derivative of the Beatles and so on. And so this is kind of like that, Back to the Four, with a song Back to the Four, very much, I think.
When the Blur album and the Oasis, when the singles were out on the same week and they were saying, oh, Blur and Oasis, it's the biggest thing since the Stones and the Beatles. Did you hear all that? I mean, were you a part of that? Did that make you have
really
a wry smile every now and again?
It was definitely the wry smile time, yeah. So, no, I thought it was great fun, and I thought it was really good marketing and made it all very interesting and exciting and so on, which is really what pop music needs all the time, you know.
But, I mean, some of it was certainly hype, but...
It was all hype.
Well, this is just my...
Well, the hype is the hype, the other stuff that goes on when you go and see the band, but it's very hard to separate the one
and
the two.
Number one is the bands genuinely don't seem to be enormously fond of each other.
Yeah, well, that's always works. That makes the hype work fantastically well. When things, part of the hype is really true, then you can really hype it.
Okay, let's play a track from the album. The album is Stripped. This is Stripped as in basic and uncomplicated, as opposed to being nude, isn't it?
Well, obviously it's like a double entendre, I suppose.
Indeed. And we're going to play Like a Rolling Stone. Has this been a regular part of your set? Was it just part on the Voodoo Lounge set?
We started doing it in the European part of the tour a few months ago, really. Recent addition to our repertoire.
From their new album, Stripped, which was out on Monday, is Like a Rolling Stone. Line 7, hello.
Hello.
Yes.
Hi, this is Kathy Hill from Thetford.
Kathy?
Yes, Kathy.
Hi, you don't sound as though you come from Thetford, Kathy.
No, I'm from America.
Whereabouts?
Texas.
How is it in Texas this morning?
Well, I wouldn't know, would I?
No, I suppose you probably wouldn't.
No, but it's rainy here.
All right, okay. Kathy?
Yes?
Song tight. What's going on there?
Oh, that's my son feeding our dog.
Well, could you do it quietly, please? It sounds okay. Like he's feeding him metal. Here, eat this saucepan, dog. Make my day. Anyway, let's have a song title, Kathy.
Big by Peter Gabriel.
And what's your theory there?
Well, my husband told me to call, and he said it's because all the people that you talk about in there are big and fat.
Yeah.
And that's basically it.
As the dog bites with another saucepan on its head. Clang, clang. Anyway, your husband, is he not there to do it himself then?
No, he had to go to work early today. They had recall today.
Oh, yeah. Is that what he calls, is it?
Yeah.
Kathy, I have to say, you're on the right lines, but it's not the right song title, I'm afraid. So when he comes back from work, you tell him he's made you look a complete silly arse.
Okay.
And commiserations to the dog.
Okay, thank you.
Thanks, bye.
Bye-bye.
Rod.
Line 6.
Line 6, hello.
Hello.
Hello, Mum. Who's that?
It's Deborah Pike from Devizes in Wiltshire.
How is it in Devizes, Deborah?
Oh, it's a bit dull this morning.
Is it?
Yeah.
Song title?
I think it could be You're the One for Me, Fatty, by Morrissey.
That's a good song. I'd forgotten about that one. And your theory there, Deborah?
Well, all the people you mention are, like, rather on the large side.
Yes.
And you're praising them all up and saying how good they all look, so sounds like they could be the ones for you.
It's not me saying it. I'm afraid totally incorrect.
Okay, then.
Thanks for calling. Thanks, then. Goodbye. Philippa.
Oh, line 5, please.
Hello?
Hello, girly line 5. Hello, who's that?
It's Jenny Inch from Liss.
Jenny Inch from Liss.
Yes.
Were you born an inch or did you marry an inch?
I married an inch.
Oh, dear.
I was a bit bigger than an inch when I was born.
Really?
Yes.
How many?
Not many.
Did you have any second thoughts about marrying someone called Inch?
No.
No, quite right too, of course. Because there are other things that matter other than a name.
Well, that's right.
That's true. Although if his name was... Bumfluff, you'd have probably thought a bit about it, wouldn't you? Because I don't think you'd like to become Mr. and Mrs. Bumfluff.
Why not?
Why not indeed? Song title, please.
Fancy Pants by Kenny.
Oh, now there's a classic.
Yes.
Why do you think that, Jenny?
Well, basically because they're all wearing fancy pants.
Are they?
Yes.
No, I don't think that's right, actually, Jenny.
Oh, all right, then.
A completely hopeless answer.
Oh, thank you very much.
Thank you for calling.
You're welcome.
Goodbye.
Bye-bye.
Very privileged to have you here anyway, but you're number one in America this weekend.
Yes.
So,
thank you.
So shouldn't you be somewhere like New York or somewhere, or back home in Houston or something?
No, we're spending our number one week right here.
Well,
in the
Evil
UK.
George and I are very, very privileged. Say yes. He's very, very pleased. And what are you going to do, first of all?
Well, we're going to sing a medley of 3 of our singles. But right now, we're going to do our first single, Bills, Bills, Bills.
Okay. Live on Radio 1, here come Destiny's Child.
At first we started out real cool, taking me places I ain't never been. But now you're getting comfortable, ain't doing those things you did no more. You're slowly making me pay for things your money should be handling. And now you ask to use my car. Drive it all day and don't fill up the tank. And you have the audacity to even come and step to me, ask to hold some money from me until you get your check next week. You're trifling, good for nothing type of brother. Oh, silly me, why haven't I found another? A baller, one time it hard, need someone to help me out. Instead of a scrub like you who don't know what a man's about. Can you pay my bills? Can you pay my telephone bills? Can you pay my automobiles? If you did, then maybe we could chill. I don't think you do, so you and me are through. Can you pay my bills? Can you pay my telephone bills? Can you pay my automobiles? If you did, then maybe we could chill. I don't think you do, so you and me are through. You're trifling, good for nothing type of brother. Oh, silly me, why haven't I found another? You're trifling, good for nothing type of brother. Oh, silly me, why haven't I found another? You're trifling, good for nothing type of brother. Oh, silly me, why haven't I found another? You're trifling, good good for nothing type of brother. Oh, silly me, why haven't I found another? Can't pay my bills, can't pay my telephone bills, can't pay my automobiles. If you did, then maybe we could chill. I don't think you do, so you and me are through. Oh, 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 oh.
It's pathetic, one person clapping.
I help you.
We'll help you.
Applaud yourself.